It is. Okay.
It's looking good. And
okay,
so
we look
this
good,
is,
they say.
This is Anna interviewing.
Gee whiz. How did we manage this?
I don't know. Luck. Gosh. Pure luck.
It must be the genes.
I think so.
Yeah. It was all your grandma's.
Grandpa. We kind of got a head start on what I wanted to talk about in the kitchen earlier.
Well, we can just repeat anything you want to hear.
So I think a lot, partly because I work with parents-to-be and new parents. I think all the time about parenthood. And so many of my friends are transitioning into this new, like, big stage in their lives. And so I'm really close to and linked to parenthood as a concept.
Yeah.
And I really know that the culture of parenthood is different now. Definitely different now than it was two generations ago. And I'm sure it's different. It's different from, you know, location to location and certainly from culture to culture, but through generations, I think parenthood really changes. Yeah. So I think I and probably people generally have a sense of kind of overall trends and stereotypes of the different of what it meant to be a parent in the or to be a parent in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. But I am excited to know more from you about what your experience of parenthood has been from the beginning. So I have some easy questions, and then I have some maybe hard questions, and you know, I'm also excited to just talk to you and see where we go. But,
okay.
I don't know how old you were when you became a parent.
Oh, that's easy. I was 24 years old.
You were 24? Yeah.
I had my 24th birthday just a few days after I met your grandmother.
Yeah.
I met her in February of 1953, and I was 24 years old in March of 1953. And she was 22 mm-hmm. at that time. Now let's see, that's not the year, of course, we were parents.
Mm-hmm.
It was the next year that we were parents, June of 54.
Mm-hmm.
So I was by that time 25,
mm-hmm.
and she was 23.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And yeah. Where were you when each of your children were born? I only know
Minnesota, the Twin Cities, for the first four.
Mm-hmm.
And Martha was born in Chattanooga
mm-hmm.
when we were there for that short, very short few years, two
mm-hmm.
and years.
Mm-hmm.
Those were not good years, but yeah. Minnesota is where your father and
yeah.
most of the family will be born.
And were Vicky and Pete and Dad and David born in the same hospital?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
University of Minnesota Hospitals, right?
And did they? Do you remember the? So I just learned, and it was a big surprise to me that you were in the room actually when.
Right.
The first four were born.
Right.
I think that was really unusual at the time.
It was not there.
Yeah.
It was at that time in Minnesota, in Minneapolis. It was very common practice. It was at that time even quite a progressive city.
Yeah.
Quite a progressive community. So it just seemed to be part of the if parents wanted to do that, that was perfectly okay with everybody there. It wasn't that way when Martha was born.
Mm-hmm.
We were in Chattanooga, and believe me, they were not progressive. You no way that you can be in around when your child's being born. No way.
And they had you. Did they have you out in the waiting room with the other dads in Chattanooga?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And do you remember where your older children were when your younger children were born?
They were home. We had a live-in maid at that time,
mm-hmm.
For a period of time when your grandmother was working at the Peerless Woolen Mills, and so we had a colored maid at that time that was a live-in maid, and she was home with the kids.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
I remember it well.
Yeah. Do you remember do you remember the preparations for, I think I'm specifically thinking of the preparations the very first time, the very first, what it was like to learn about pregnancy, about labor, about delivery, about even the early postpartum days. Did you take a childbirth ed class, or
nope.
do you know?
They just, nope. And there was a reason for that. I believe there was a reason for it. For one thing, I was a student.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have time mm-hmm. for that, and we also I was also working to help support the two
yeah.
of us,
yeah.
soon to be
yeah.
three of us.
Yeah.
And so I didn't have time for that.
Yeah.
And your grandmother had been in pre-med uh-huh. and had spent a lot of time
yeah.
on hospital wards and in doctor's offices and so forth.
Yeah.
She had worked in a clinic at some point in time, and so she was well versed
yeah.
in the whole business of what to expect and so forth.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
No, she was already, I think she felt probably more prepared than she may in fact have actually
so
been.
That, so
she's not here to defend herself
yeah.
now, so.
Did she, was there fear in the, was she afraid of the process of birth?
Not one
yeah.
bit.
Yeah.
Fear was not something your grandmother ever knew much about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And did you have fear
no.
about the process of birth?
No.
No.
I wasn't smart enough to be fearful.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
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 And
yeah. It was a natural thing, a normal thing.
Yeah.
So no reason to be fearful that
yeah.
I thought of.
Yeah. Yeah. That's interesting. And you just said that she maybe thought she was more prepared than she. I'm curious what
I can
made
only
you
speculate
that.
About
mm-hmm.
that,
mm-hmm.
you know. She knew an awful lot
mm-hmm.
about medical procedures,
mm-hmm.
Hospital procedures.
Mm-hmm.
She had spent a lot of time with doctors and in hospitals. She had spent a lot of time working there in hospitals,
mm-hmm.
not that particular one, but over the years
mm-hmm.
beforehand.
Yeah.
She had thought at until I came along and talked her into marrying me. She had really thought that when she got done with her bachelor's degree, she was going to go on and prepare to be a medical missionary.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
So that
yeah.
was what had been in the back of her mind
yeah.
all along. Our children came along 9 months and 6 days after we were married, so therefore that sort of had an influence on
uh-huh.
what she did and did not
for
do.
Sure. For sure, for sure.
Yeah.
Do you remember whether you knew, I don't know what the technology was at the time, did you know if you were having boys or girls, or did you find out
nope.
when they arrived?
Nope, we found out when they arrived.
Yeah.
That technology didn't exist.
Yeah, I wasn't
or if
sure.
it did, we didn't know about
yeah,
it. I
yeah.
don't think it existed
it
at that
have.
Time. No.
Yeah, or it might not have been good enough. For a long time, it was just through ultrasound, so it may not have been creating strong enough images for them.
I don't
to
recall
know.
That ultrasound even
yeah.
was a part of procedure.
Honestly,
at that
I don't know either.
Yeah.
This time. Yeah.
But this is early 1950s.
Yeah.
So early mid 1950s. So
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
that's a whole different time
yeah.
from. That's a long time ago, medically.
A long time
medically
ago.
Speaking,
yeah.
seriously.
Yeah, yeah. And do you remember? Did you pick out names ahead of time, or did you? What was the process of naming
yeah.
the children?
I don't remember what the alternative was. I don't remember if we had had a girl. What we had for our firstborn.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember that. What it was that
mm-hmm.
we had chosen, but I know that we had chosen to name our firstborn Peter.
Mm-hmm.
And middle name Turner after her father.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And do you remember what the rest of them what did you decide after they arrived?
Yep.
Did you yeah, you
yep,
decided.
Pretty much. We may have talked about possibilities,
mm-hmm.
but I don't think we decided until we knew what it was gonna be
yeah.
and then we decided what it was going to be.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, you don't know. It's so different from nowadays.
It's so different. Yeah.
Nowadays, you have the opportunity to medically know whether you're having a boy or a girl, you even have the prospect of knowing if you have, if you need to expect some difficulties.
Exactly. Yeah.
Which has its good, good aspects, and those that maybe. Maybe the aspect of surprise removes, and the fact that that doesn't exist anymore, removes a sense of wonder about it all.
Yeah, that's interesting.
You know?
Yeah.
And I can only say that because it was such an incredibly wonderful thing.
Yeah.
When our all five of ours were born.
Yeah.
It's just so incredibly.
It's
wonderful.
Incredible. Yeah.
I had no idea.
Yeah.
What they were going to be.
Yeah.
And certainly, we had no idea. Had no idea what they'd turn out to be.
Sure.
To say nothing about then their children.
I know. Well, that's kind of part of, you know, I don't even know what the concrete questions are in this in my notes, but yeah, but the element of surprise, I'm sure, just continues to come up as you observe who your children are, and certainly then who your children, the people that your children raise. And then some, you have a couple great-grandchildren, so the people that you raised through,
four great-grandchildren.
That's incredible.
It is incredible.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
To still be so much alive as I feel that I am, and, and, have five children, 12 grandchildren, four great-grandchildren, and who knows what's on the way, you know.
Yeah.
First of our, my grandsons are finally getting married, as we all know, this summer.
Your, this is kind of related to names. Your kids call you Pop now, but I'm curious.
They call me a little bit of everything. Yeah. Grandpa, Grandpop, I haven't gotten much "Hey you" lately, but no, they call me a little bit of everything.
Do they call you Dad or do they?
Children?
Yeah, do your kids call you Dad? Or have they always called you Pop?
I get both.
Yeah.
I get both, and I won't say who, but one of them even calls me Daddy once in a while.
Yeah, and what did you call your dad? Do you remember the name?
I called him Dad.
You called him Dad.
Yeah.
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 And what did you call your mom?
Mom.
Mom.
That was it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you remember if you and Grandma talked about, so nowadays there are, millions, billions of books for people to read and courses and, you know, there are, you can have someone come into your home and teach you how to get your children to sleep. I mean, there's so many ideas about how to raise your children.
Yeah.
And I think, I'm sure that's always been true, but I imagine that it was more that we just learned how to parent from our parents rather than from books.
That's exactly the way it came.
Yeah. And do you remember learning from Grandma what her, did the two of you discuss parenthood before your children came along or as you went? Was it something that you were interested in talking about, or was it kind of a natural dynamic between you, or?
It was more or less a natural dynamic, and let me explain why. One of the things that is a truth about of our beginning of life, your grandmother's and mine, was that we had not really had the opportunity that so many people have had. It seems to be less these days, but we did not have the opportunity to really get to know each other very well before we got married. We decided to get married in the spring of 1953.
Mm-hmm.
We got married in the late summer, August 29th.
Mm-hmm.
Of 1953.
Mm-hmm.
For 6-8 weeks of that time in between, I was either in Denton, Texas, studying with my father, who was teaching summer school there, or your grandmother was in Massachusetts getting ready for the wedding with her parents.
Yeah.
So we did not have the real opportunity that all of us, I believe, really should have to get to know each other well before we got married.
Mm-hmm.
We got married, we were virtually immediately expecting our first child, son, and so we never had the opportunity to get acquainted in any kind of a normal way. That's, in my opinion, has, I think, been a very, very great loss for us. It is too bad that we didn't really have a chance to know each other. We didn't have a chance to, therefore, either even know ourselves very well. We were both students. She was finishing up, and I was just coming back to being a student after being in the military for 3.5 years.
And so both of you must have been parenting from instinct and ideas about what was right based on what your parents, how your parents parented.
Or didn't
parent.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Did you feel like you wanted to parent differently than your parents parented?
I think all of us wants to do what we do differently than our parents ever did. I think there's nothing surprising about that dynamic. I think that's pretty normal for almost all of us. We want to do things better than our parents ever did.
Sure.
I mean,
sure.
Those antiques, what did they know? Huh?
Well, maybe.
You know, well,
yeah.
there was a little bit of that in your grandmother's and my case. I had felt that my parents had really not done a very good job for me. They had been, my father was an old country autocrat. That's all he knew. I do not accuse him of that. That's only being descriptive of the only experience he'd ever had. So we really had to learn as we went along, and we didn't have much time to learn.
And then you have all these different people, these different personalities that you had to learn partly from your children, I imagine, how to parent.
A little bit.
Do you feel that
a heck of a lot.
Actually. Yeah. Do you feel that you parented each of them differently?
Each one of them?
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting question. I think we probably did parent each one of them a little differently, for the simple reason, the very obvious reason, that each one of our children was different. They had, each of them, different characteristics, different responses, or a lack of response, and on occasion, that's an interesting question to raise.
Yeah.
It was every single one of them was different.
Sure.
Every single one of them was different.
Sure.
And I'll be the first to say that we didn't always do it very well.
What do you
Not
think?
Very many parents, if they're truly honest,
yeah.
I think would say that they did it perfectly
well. Oh, sure. No one says that. What?
Nobody should say that.
No, exactly. What would be the signs of not doing it well? Is it a feeling that you have, or is it some knowledge that you have that makes you say that? I'm just curious.
That's a hard one.
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah.
I know, that is a very, very hard one. And I think the only way I can really answer that is to say that post facto, any of us, if we're honest, would have to say that looking back on any former year and that year's experiences in our lives, we could have done better.
Exactly.
I don't think that there's a one of us, if we're really honest, that can't look back on any moment in our lives and say, could have done that a lot better.
Yeah.
Or at least a little bit better.
Yeah.
Or,
yeah.
And there's not a year that I can look back in my past that I can honestly say that, boy, that was a year that was perfect.
Oh, sure.
and so in that sense, yeah. I don't think there's any possibility of looking yeah. back and saying that, no, I've yeah. done everything
yeah.
the best way I possibly yeah. could. I don't think that's humanly possible.
Right. Well, and maybe partly because
I would like to talk to you, as a matter of fact, about this subject in reverse
exactly.
in about 20 sure. years from now. See?
All right, let's do it. Sign me up.
But this, I think that's just reality.
I think
for
so
all
too.
Of us.
Yeah, I think so too. I just, I guess I was just curious because you said it a couple times that you feel that you could have done better. But sure, but you know, you take a right turn, you take a left turn, and you. But you, I guess part of my question is, do you feel like you're still parenting? You have 5 children.
Not really. I think that no, I really don't think I'm parenting. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what I really do think that I'm doing, and that is having the satisfaction of having, instead of 5 children,
mm-hmm.
I'm having 5 superbly wonderful friends.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, there's a time when we become friends and do I ever counsel any of them?
Mm-hmm.
They don't ask for much, but I'm not one of those people that feels that I ought to butt into their lives mm-hmm. much. I really don't.
Mm-hmm.
Every once in a while I wonder if I shouldn't butt in maybe a little bit more than I do. But
yeah.
No.
I don't feel like
yeah. I need to parent my children.
But that's an interesting thing. So, you know, who am I to say? But yeah. I feel like the part of from, you know, my position, and I'm not a parent, is that I feel like part of the act of parenting is developing relationship. And you still yeah. you are yeah. developing relationships yeah. with your yeah. children, and
I think that's one of the wonderful, truly wonderful things, Anna, about this time in life.
Yeah.
Certainly for us in our
yeah.
family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the relationship that I have the privilege of having with my children, each mm-hmm. one of my children and their families,
mm-hmm.
is really just about one of the real great joys of my life.
Mm-hmm.
Parenting, I don't think I need to do any longer. Counseling once in a while, if it's ever appropriate, no reluctance, if
mm-hmm.
it's appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
There are things that I'm beginning to realize in my age, and hopefully a little bit of wisdom in a couple of corners of mm-hmm. my life, I have the idea that I ought to share while I'm still here with my grandchildren
mm-hmm.
to tell them some things that you all that, you know, think about this or that
yeah.
a little bit more seriously in this way
yeah.
because it can affect your life for the rest
yeah.
of your life.
Yeah.
And I've been thinking very, very seriously in recent months, the last couple of years especially, that there's some things that I really want to share
yeah.
with my grandchildren.
Yeah.
It's too late for my children.
Oh, maybe.
I'm available to any of them.
Sure.
Anytime that's appropriate.
What are some of those things that you'd like to share with your grandchildren?
That's a hard one.
Yeah.
A lot of it, I think, in truth, one of the main areas that I have some concern about is our spiritual lives. And I don't mean in terms of I'm not talking about religious
mm-hmm.
lives.
Mm-hmm.
That's a different subject.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm talking about our spiritual being, which each of us is.
Mm-hmm.
And how do we think of that?
Mm-hmm.
How do we anticipate how we develop that part of our being in the best way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And there are some things that, in my observation, I don't know how you feel about this, but in regards to your parents, but I know darn well that in my own children, I have not been in many respects the kind of example that I wish I had been, that I wish I were.
In terms of that point.
And I'd like to tell my grandchildren about that, because they also, every one of my grandchildren, each of you, will also, I have an idea, feel that they could have gotten a few insights from each of your parents that would have been of beneficial if more had been shared in the way of wisdom.
Yeah.
So there is a little bit of that that I am really thinking serious about.
Yeah.
Now there's not, who knows how much time I have.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I'm blessed, as it appears anyway, I'm blessed with, in spite of last year's medical events, with a pretty ding-busted healthy life.
Yeah, perhaps because of
and,
that.
And maybe, yeah, maybe, but, and maybe, maybe I'll be around for long enough to be able to act successfully in this arena. I hope so.
Well, we sure hope
we'll
so.
See what happens.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
You're the first one to ask that question, really.
Yeah, about what might you share?
Yeah.
With. Yeah.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
How do you have a sense of how you might share that? Do you think that just conversation is the best way, or do you think that writing?
No.
I know. I feel that you like to You're good at writing your
I'll
thoughts,
probably
too.
Write it.
Yeah.
I'll probably write it. Not that my writing is the best thing that I do, it's not. But I think that what I want to share a bit of, really, I would like it to be on common ground.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way to do that is not individually with each one, because everybody then interprets it, you will anyway. In your in your own experience framework.
Yeah.
I think that really at least putting it in the same words that everybody receives, deals with, at least there's a good starting point. Then if you all want to talk with each other about it, then at least you have the common ground to work from.
The material.
Yeah.
Right. That's as pure a form as it could be.
Who says anything about purity?
Well, just meaning
no, <I'm kidding. laughs>
if we are to debate the meaning,
exactly.
We have your actual, chosen, the words that you chose yourself.
And I usually try to choose my words carefully.
Yeah.
Most of
the time. Would that be something that you would, did you teach your children to choose their words carefully? Do you have a sense whether that was,
it's a funny thing. I think I think one of the truths about being a parent and grandparent is that our children have a hard time listening to things from parents.
Okay.
I did.
Sure.
But I sure would listen to my grandfather and my grandmother.
Interesting.
Whenever they spoke, I would really listen to them. And I sense that there's, in some of the few conversations, one of the nice things that I wish you were here in this part of the world too, so it would be true for you too, but one of the nice things is to be able to take Sol and Jeff and
all the rest of those guys,
any of them that happen to be around out to lunch, and
we
just sit and jaw for a while.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen very often, it doesn't happen a lot, but it happens enough that I am, I wish I could do more of that.
Right. Well, some people have four grandchildren, and you have 12 grandchildren. So there's a way in which
I may pester you on the telephone a little bit more than you're ready for.
I hope so.
The only problem with that is then you have to pay for all that time on your cotton picking phone.
No.
You don't have a home phone, do you?
I don't.
No. See what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Right.
Was there anything that I guess I was imagining this as something you may have taught your children as children, but maybe this could be something you taught your children later in life. Is there anything that you especially enjoyed teaching your children? could be something like riding a bike, or could be something like something specific about music, or could be something about like a life lesson, or...
Riding a bike. I remember teaching your Uncle Pete how to ride a bike out in the front of our house in Chattanooga, Tennessee.
Yeah.
Boy, that was quite an experience. He's good.
Do you know how old would he have been?
Oh, he would have been 59. Gee whiz. No, that's not possible. 63, 62, 61, 60. About 7.
Uh-huh.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Maybe 6, possibly 7, mm-hmm. 8, mm-hmm. something like that. You asked another question just with that about the same time. What
about,
was it?
Just about teaching, was there anything that you especially enjoyed teaching your children?
It's funny you mentioned that you raised something about music.
Mm-hmm.
You're not aware of this probably at this particular point, but your Uncle David,
mm-hmm.
has pretty much persuaded me that I need to put down my list of the 100 pieces of music that I want each of my family to know something more about and why.
Amazing.
And he started me thinking on that, and I've already got quite a list already going. It's just barely getting started. This has only happened in the last month or so.
Yeah.
Maybe a couple of months.
Yeah.
And so there are things that I still like to teach.
Yeah.
Pass on, and there are some things that I have in my experience that are not part of my family's experience,
mm-hmm.
and mainly mm-hmm. in the music arena.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so I take seriously his request to share some of that, share what makes a piece of music so thrilling to me. And there are some pieces of music, there's a lot of music that truly is.
Yeah, and that's a great way.
And it comes from surprising corners.
That's a great way for your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and friends and, you know, everyone to know more about music, but also to know more about you, to have
that question with me without learning something goes along with it about me, too.
Yeah, exactly.
I learned about a piece of music today, which is all my latest favorite piece of music, a setting of Psalm 23, "The Lord is My Shepherd." By, of all people in the world, Bobby McFerrin.
Huh. Wow. Surprising.
Yeah. And I just was hit by it this afternoon, earlier this afternoon. And it may be one of my top 45 or so right now.
Wow.
You know, it happens all the time.
Yeah. That new pieces of music that are new to you become favorites. Yeah. Were there traditions from your childhood that you felt were important to have as part of your family life? In your family with grandma and your children?
Boy, that's a hard one.
And that, just a companion question to that is, just in case it changes the question at all, do you remember if there were traditions that were from grandma's family that were sacred to her and that became part of your family's traditions?
You know, I can't think of any one thing.
Yeah.
I really can't. Mm-hmm. The one overarching area that your grandmother and I had that was really in common and really bound us together in the strongest ways virtually for our entire lives? Mm. Good question. I hadn't really thought of this quite this way for a long time. Mm. But the one area of life that we held in common in the strongest way is probably the amount of time and effort and thought and energy and work that we put into, in the case of both of us, not just me,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
in the case of the music in church.
Mm-hmm.
That has been virtually for our entire lives
mm-hmm.
The common thread that we both, just saying that we were fond of, it just doesn't cover of it. It
yeah.
absorbed us.
Yeah.
It
yeah.
truly absorbed us in everything else that we did in life, in one way or another, supported us being able to pursue that common thread.
Wow.
And I don't think I've ever quite put it that way for any of you before. And nobody's asked that question quite that way. And I think that that may be perhaps the one thing that, it's also true with Becky and me.
Mm-hmm.
It's the one thing that binds us most in common
mm-hmm.
because we have that in common
mm-hmm.
between the two of us,
mm-hmm.
the three of us, as a matter
mm-hmm.
of fact, because
yeah.
Becky and your grandmother were such close friends for so
yeah.
many years,
yeah.
Long before Becky came into my life.
Mm-hmm.
That's been the common thread for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the reasons why it's been kind of interesting to me that that has not been true. That has not carried on.
It's true.
That has not carried on to any of the
mm-hmm.
next generations.
It's true. Yeah.
That doesn't mean there's disinterest. I don't mean that at all. I don't mean to suggest that at all. It's not a matter of disinterest or avoiding. It's just a matter of it's not a common thread
mm-hmm.
in the same way that it was for your
mm-hmm.
grandmother or
mm-hmm.
me.
And that the and that especially given the strength of that influence, the influence of that in your lives, that that
has,
might be a surprise.
It has been the overwhelming
yeah.
strength in
yeah.
our lives.
Yeah.
No
yeah.
question about it. It
yeah.
has been the overwhelmingly strong constant.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you so that sounds like a one of the many ways that I'm sure you're surprised to learn how, or to see how your children, the things that your children were and were not interested in that were part of your lives. So you have music, your children are musical, but only Martha has pursued it as a profession.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Are there ways that you, I mean, this is maybe too big of a question, but are there obvious ways that you're surprised that the things, the kinds of interests that your children did have or the kinds of interests that your children did not have? So, I don't know, maybe that's, it's a little too big, but I don't know, just...
Well, you know, how can we ever figure out why it is that our children choose or find fascinating or are compelled by, in their interests, a certain direction in life?
Mm-hmm.
Why is it that each of us goes a certain way?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that, at the same time I say what I just said about your grandmother and me, and also Becky
mm-hmm.
and me, one of the things that's been a constant is that we also have had extraordinarily diverse other
mm-hmm.
interests as well. We have had interests in Oh, good grief. Many, many other things as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we haven't been only narrowly interested in that area.
Mm-hmm.
That's just been the main common constant thread.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas there's also been an awful lot of other things in life as well.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
And the same thing has been true, I think, for all of our children.
Yeah.
And certainly is for
yeah.
our grandchildren.
Yeah, exactly.
And some of you are still, as we were talking earlier at dinner table, still doing a little bit of searching.
Searching. Probably endlessly. Many of us are probably doing searching.
Well, that goes on, you know, that goes on in your entire life.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And that's okay.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
I think that one of the things that's true about us human beings is that we have many, many, many opportunities for developing various skills. And there are so many different ways of being challenged by one at one time and another arena at another time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I was awfully, awfully, awfully good at producing soundtracks for films, for film producers, for a bunch of years. Why is it that that's true for a while and no more?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
interesting.
See?
Right. Right. That is interesting. Potentially because something different opened up for you and it felt the opening up kind of canceled out the other talent or gift that you had.
Yeah, nothing's ever canceled out the mainstream.
Yeah.
That's always been there.
That's interesting, yeah.
That's been there nonstop, all the way through.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it was for your grandmother, too.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been a constant in Becky's life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That one thread.
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting.
I had a question handed to me. Any comments on a family tradition of the sharing of food with guests? And with guests and grandparents and family, sharing.
I don't know exactly where that question is wanting to go, but you know, food is a common for all of us.
Yeah.
And food is the way we express so many things.
Yeah.
It's not just how we keep ourselves alive and provide ourselves bodily strength, which is certainly true.
Mm-hmm.
But it also is an opportunity for community sharing within families and beyond families from within a family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, we've had a lot of
yeah.
A lot of sharing with not only our family but with others outside of our family through food.
Yeah.
Like the meals that we had tonight.
Exactly. And there is, I can think of ways that, so tradition, cultural traditions are often handed down through food. I know, I, just a couple years ago, I think I told my dad that I was making yogurt. I make yogurt. And my dad shared with me something that I had never known, which was that your father made yogurt.
Your great-grandfather.
My great-grandfather made yogurt.
Constantly.
Uh-huh. Which is what you have to do, because you have to use the starter. So
right.
I think it moved my dad to be given the opportunity to remember the ways that his grandfather made yogurt. And I think he said he would eat it with molasses on it. Do you
remember? He loved it with molasses, yeah. I don't blame him. I did,
yeah,
too.
Sure. Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
So,
it's a great way to get a little sweet in your life, I'll tell you.
Exactly. Yeah, not bad food. So food is, so there's cultural tradition that gets handed down through food, and then there's also just the sharing in the, just in the moment of food.
Well, your grandmother was great at that. She was, you know, there's so many different ways of focusing on preparing food, and her way was very casual, very casual, and she was very, very comfortable. Just all of a sudden, in the middle of of a Sunday morning, deciding that she was going to invite two or three people over for a Sunday lunch. She hadn't even thought about any food.
Yeah.
And just make do with whatever happened to be around. And we'd gather around the table in our house and have a few friends. And,
yeah.
And as long as we had a bottle of wine or two, we were okay.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I was wondering...
Everybody handles that kind of a thing differently.
Oh, it's so
Everybody
true.
Does.
It's so true. Yeah. So true. I was wondering if you have had the experience that most people report having of realizing in adulthood that you are so much like your parents, like either of your parents or both of your parents. Do you feel that you are like your parents?
In certain, mostly subtle ways, yes. Yeah. I'm like my mother in terms of a certain kind of spontaneity. She was a very spontaneous kind of a person. She was raised in a farm family. Her father was a farmer. And I spent most of my boyhood summers on that farm. So I appreciate the importance of raising food and preparing food and sharing food around a big table, which is what happened all the time in a farm. But on the other hand, in the case of my father, he had a remarkable, truly a remarkable insight to the importance of how you listen to music. He, I think, passed on to certainly his two sons, me and my brother. He certainly passed on an ability to listen to music with a kind of ear that could draw a lot of insight to what the real inner meaning of that music was. Any music. And he's dealt, to begin with serious music. He was not much for entertainment, just for the sake of entertainment. When he brought home an Andre Castellanet's Christmas record once, that was about as far away from serious music that I ever knew him to go. And that was quite something when he did that, as a matter of fact. And Andre Castellanos is, of course, not even known by most of your generation. He was an orchestra conductor with a lot of lush strings and so forth. But he taught us how to listen to music. And most of your parents' generation, if not all of them, learned to one degree or another something of that. Same thing, because we had the great gift of living a block away from my parents during the most important growing up years in my kids' youthful childhood. And so they go out the back door of our house, into the back door of their house, down the next block, and spend a lot of time with them. And so they picked up a lot of that. And you can't be in my father's house without experiencing something of the art of listening to music. So in that respect, there's a sensitivity to music that that I inherited from him.
Yeah.
No question about that.
And what about your children? Do you have ways that you believe that your children, that you feel that your kids are like you and Grandma? That they have some
No, they got, in every case, they got the worst of us. No,
no,
that's
no,
you know,
yeah.
I'm kidding.
Yeah.
That's a hard question.
Yeah, I mean,
you know,
it's easy.
That
it's
really,
true.
How do you look at your own children to figure out what they got?
Right, and I think, I mean, when it comes up, when you're like, oh my gosh, I'm so much like my mom, things come up, and like all of us say, happens, which really does happen.
Yeah, it does.
But it comes over you almost like this, this sensation, this wave of like emotion or realization, and it's a little bit different if you're to look at your children and be like, oh, I have no idea what that would even be like to see how your children are like you, but yeah.
No, the only easy answer, there is no easy answer for in almost all cases of my children, except for one easy answer, and that's only because she has chosen to be a professional musician.
Mm-hmm.
In the case of Martha, there are certain musical insights that I know she and I share.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's a natural enough mm-hmm. thing to observe mm-hmm. since she is the only one in the family that mm-hmm. has become a professional
mm-hmm.
like I am.
Mm-hmm.
And but that doesn't mean that that doesn't exist in other members of the family. It does. There's a musical sensitivity in David, your Uncle David, that is totally different.
Oh.
But boy, does he have it.
Huh.
Your father, I probably know less about how much of that he has inherited from me.
Mm.
In his case, Vicky loves it, but she stays away from it pretty much.
Uh-huh.
And Pete, he loves to sing in my choir.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's your cuz Alice.
Yeah, that's what I hear.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes her a lot of fun for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a hard question to really answer knowingly.
I know. Yeah.
I don't think
sure.
that. I don't think that. In all honesty, any of us as parents can answer that question really well.
Yeah.
It's looking the wrong direction.
Yeah, you know? Right, exactly. Yeah. Did any of your kids, or do any of your kids come to you for parenting advice? Or advice, yeah, parenting advice?
Not only no, but hell no.
what not to do?
They've got all the answers.
Right.
And I seriously, I mean that seriously.
Yeah.
Once in a while, Martha and I will talk about some of the struggles that she and Ken have with Sophia and Nathan
mm-hmm.
A little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's not in any painful way of it
mm-hmm.
all. Just, you know, after all, she's a parent of just about to get loose in the world teenagers.
Right.
You know? And
yeah.
and that's the toughest part time to be a parent and
yeah.
for many of us.
Yeah.
And so there's that kind of conversation, but I wouldn't know that you'd call it she's asking for advice or seeking
right.
counsel or anything
right. Right.
of that kind of a thing.
Yeah.
I don't think that's
yeah.
the case at all.
Were there did your kids come to you to talk about career and work type things as they were finding their way?
Rarely.
Rarely.
Yeah, I don't think really, no.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a reason for that. Their mother, your grandmother, was a very, very independent kind of a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very independent person. And I think if there's anything that she sort of passed on to all five of our children, it is a certain amount of independence to think for yourself
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and draw your own conclusions and figure your own way.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly do the same thing
mm-hmm.
and struggle with it as we've already talked
mm-hmm.
about earlier this evening. Plenty of it for long into my adulthood, and which a lot of people do. There's nothing
mm-hmm.
unusual about that
mm-hmm.
anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an interesting thing to think about. Our children don't seek an awful lot of counsel. Mm-hmm. We don't offer an awful lot, but you know, when it's yeah. appropriate, we share.
Yeah, and maybe that over the.
I certainly celebrate. I tell you that.
You celebrate the your children.
You bet.
And
grandchildren.
Yeah, and grandchildren.
You bet.
Yeah. Well, your children and grandchildren celebrate you too. And.
Just the fact that I stuck around so long already.
not at all. I don't know where we are with time, but I think.
I have no idea where we are with time either. Maybe your Uncle Pete can walk in here and do a little calculation and do a little counseling on us. I think he's walking in our direction, I think, at this particular point. Maybe not.
There's a question that I didn't write, but was about
6 minutes or 5 minutes.
5 or 6 minutes left.
4 minutes and 17 seconds.
Okay.
Perfect. There's a question about your parents. If your parents were to share a personal message or the word that someone else wrote in the question was message with you and their grandchildren. Do you have a sense what a message that your parents would give? Maybe the idea of the question is like, is there something that they would want to kind of pass on, like a lesson from their lives that they might want to pass on through the generations? Is there something that your parents prioritized in their kind of human connections in their lives?
That they would want to share for
they would want to share
with their next generation,
my
generation, and then on down.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a big question. I stole it from someone else. I didn't write it.
And with
myself.
4 minutes left or less now, I don't even think that can be broached. I honestly don't even know how to start thinking about that.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a big one.
It's also, you know, what's also hard about that is it's asking you to choose to speak for your parents, which could just be by nature very hard to do.
Very hard to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
I really can't come up with an answer to that one. That's a very, very hard one.
I don't know, this one's going to be, these are all going to be hard, big ones. Are there lessons from your parents that you understand more as an adult than you did as a child? That's also hard.
I think that one is almost ready for, that's for a different session. That's a hard one.
Well, here, I won't make you work for this. I'll just tell you that today I was I just had a little bit of time to meet up with Dad. And so Andrew and I met Dad and we were taking a walk and we're telling him that we're preparing for our interview, that I was preparing for the interview tonight. And so we're talking to you and we're talking to Dad about you. And Dad says, he's a good man. And he says, actually, he's a beautiful man. And so I just want to say, my dad said that about you, and I just want to say that when it comes, so, and then when we, and then when we parted ways with my dad, whereas I was thinking the same about my dad, just how much I love my dad.
Exactly.
And then I think if there's a legacy of parenthood, of good parenthood, of, it's if you're, if the generations look at each other and say, not just to each other, but about one another, that they're that they appreciate the beauty in one another, then I think parenting was well done. And so I want to.
I think we're all fortunate
express,
in this war.
Yeah,
and I think we are.
And it's fortune, and it's also, you know, hard work and deep love, and so.
I look at every one of my grandchildren and think, how did I, as a grandpa, come out this fortunate? You know?